from whirlwind and burning bush, in the still of the night and in sheer silence. God calls the faithful to sacred work, beckoning us to turn aside, inviting us to stand on holy ground. God welcomes the faithful into sacred space. Come, God is calling. Let us worship the Lord together.
Just
Jesus Christ overcame evil with good, so that all people might be saved from sin. Let us then confess our need for grace, confident in God's forgiveness. Let us pray. Compassionate God, who hears the cries of the oppressed, you call us to resist evil and hold fast to what is good, to take up the cross and commit our lives to the cause of love. But we are afraid to confront powers that privilege some and diminish others. We do not want to lose the security we enjoy. Forgive us. Open our ears to hear your voice, our eyes to look upon neighbors in need, and our hearts to respond with compassion, that we might follow the way of Christ. And now hear us, we pray, as we bring to you our own personal and silent confessions. Amen. Jesus took up his cross for our salvation. In return for our old life of sin, he promises a new life of grace. Know this morning that you are forgiven, and be at peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we approach God's word together, let us first pray for illumination. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, who spoke to Moses from the burning bush, speak to us now in the reading and proclaiming of your word. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. Listen, this is the story of God for the people of God. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness. He came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings. And I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" He said, "I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.' This is my name forever, and this my title for all generations." Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, our text this morning may be a familiar one to some of us. It presents some striking imagery and even more memorable verses. So let's take a look at a few of them. To begin, God calls to Moses, and Moses responds, "Here I am." Moses, even though not looking for God in this moment, gets drawn upon holy ground, drawn into God's plan of deliverance and freedom for the Israelites. And he responds how we should respond when called. "Here I am." Next, in verse 7, "I have observed the misery of my people. I know their sufferings. I have come down to deliver them." God has compassion for God's people. God is not silent about injustice and not indifferent about the pains that have been endured. So God chooses to act, specifically through Moses. Now, while this was undoubtedly overwhelming to Moses, God reassures him by saying in verse 12, "I will be with you." God's plan isn't dependent on Moses' own characteristics or abilities, but on God, who was with him. Then God finishes off this memorable string of events by saying probably the most famous and mysterious of all the sayings of the story, "I am who I am." Now, while God's name may be the greatest mystery of the story, what's more significant than the meaning behind it is that the name of God, the name that God gives, speaks more to God's character and fidelity to Moses and to God's people. So let's recap. "Here I am. I know their sufferings. I will be with you. I am who I am." Incredibly, though, what mostly caught my attention this week was not on those well-known aspects of the story, although it is related, but it was the burning bush, the one that was blazing, yet was not consumed. It immediately brought to mind for me one of my favorite verses from Isaiah 43. "But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned. And the flame shall not consume you." For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames shall not consume you. The bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. In one particular show that I watch often, they had fantasy book author Patrick Rothfuss on as a guest star. In this episode, his particular character has been aiding in the rebuilding of a town that had been ravaged by war. He writes a letter to one of the main characters who has also been going through a tough time. He says this in the letter. The folk in charge argue constantly, but that is to be expected. I listen mostly and do what I can to make sure they listen to each other. Without listening, nothing good can happen. The town, when I say the repair is going well, it's a hard thing for me to talk about. I'm not a particularly clever man, and much of this is new to me. When you make a mistake with metal, you can melt things down and start fresh. It's irritating, and it costs in time and soot and sweat, but it can be done. There's comfort in iron, knowing that a fresh start is always possible. But a city is not a sword. It is a living thing, and living things defy simple fixing. Roots cannot be reforged. They scar, and broken branches must be cut and sealed with tar. And this makes me angry, as it always has, and my anger has no place to go. It was easier when I was young. I could use my anger like a hammer against the world. I was so sure of myself and my friends and my rightness. I would hammer at the world, and breaking felt like making to me. And I was good at it. And while I was not wrong, neither was I entirely right. Nothing is simple. I do not work with wood. I'm not brave enough for that. Because there is comfort in iron. A promise of safety. A second chance if mistakes are made. But a city is more a forest than a sword. No, it needs more tending than that. Perhaps a city is like a garden, then. So these days, it seems that I have become a gardener. I dig foundations in the earth. I sow rows of houses. I plan and plant. I watch the skies for rain and ruin. Rothfuss's character continues. Did you know that there are some seeds that cannot sprout unless they are first burned? A friend once told me that. She was the bookish sort. I think of gardening constantly these days, and I think it's interesting that there are some living things that need to pass through fire before they flourish. I am not wise and I do not give advice, but I have come to know a few things. Sometimes breaking is making. Even iron can start again. And there are many things that move through fire and find themselves much better for it afterward. And close with the letter that his character sent was a ring for the young heroine that had these words inscribed on it. I have passed through fire. I have passed through fire. Folks, the fact that you are here listening to me this morning means that you have passed through fire. It's clear from my time as a funeral director and my short time here as a pastor that there is so much hardship and suffering and pain in the world. No one is immune to it. It's a part of life. And you folks here at St. Andrew are no exception. Each week we have new prayer requests that come in from members who are struggling or have people in their life who need prayer. And even those of you who are not members of St. Andrew but are watching, I'm sure that you can speak to your own adversities. But I want you to hear the good news this morning. You have endured. You may be enduring something right now. You may feel as though you are blazing and engulfed in flames. But let me tell you, God, the great I am who I am, who knows your suffering, is with you. And you will not be consumed. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
All around.
Sisters and brothers, God is faithful and gracious to us, upholds us, and raises us up. So let us now show our thanksgiving by giving generously to support ministries that ease burdens and give rest to those in need. Let us pray. Compassionate God, we ask that you bless and multiply these gifts. that they may be used to proclaim the glory of your kingdom and make known to all people the power of your saving acts. Amen. Let us now approach the great I am who I am with our concerns and our prayers of intercession for this community, for the church, and for the world. Let us pray. Steadfast God, your love and faithfulness are with us always. We give thanks that with you there is no end to our hope. By your power, all exiles will come to an end. All things will be restored. Therefore, we pray with confidence to you who are above all things, knowing that you take notice of those who are bent low, that your strong arm takes hold of those who are in the midst of trouble. To anyone in despair, send your deliverance swiftly. For those longing for home, return them, we pray, to a place of safety and love. For anyone estranged from another, we pray that reconciliation may be accomplished, or that an ending may become the pathway to a new beginning. Loving God, you promise comfort to the one in sorrow and help to the one in trouble. Lift us all up so that we can see your salvation. This morning, we especially pray for Barb and Ed Weil. For Betty and John Brandon. For Peggy McMahon, for Virginia and Jim Wright, for Turner Matthews' mother, for Seal Heidrich's aunt Lloyd Lewis Breland, for Jim Hurst, for teachers and students as they navigate their new school situations, and for anyone left unspoken. Help us and help the nations to learn your justice and to practice it. We thank you for the gift of the church and for the varied gifts and perspectives you place among us. We especially thank you for the life and service of Leslie Matthews, with whom we celebrate her 30 years of service to both Covenant and St. Andrew Presbyterian churches. We thank you especially for Jesus Christ, who has called us to be his body in the world, and who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Friends, as you leave this time of worship, my prayer and my hope is that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love, now and forevermore. Amen.